Hi, everybody. What up, Jess? Thank you for joining, and thank you, Frug'Agile, to let me present today. Today, I'm here to tell you a story about what I learned through my journey and what I would have liked to know before starting my journey. As a software developer, I wanted to share my experience with you through some important topics which allowed me to move further. Please note that it's totally fine if you disagree with me, but what I will tell you is my personal story. First, let me present myself. I'm Ismai, Nguyen, a 29 years old software architect based in Switzerland and working currently for international beauty and skincare company. Before starting, let's do a quick icebreaker in which we will discover the first principle thinking through an exercise. Here is a maze with Pikachu in the left, who wants to join the Pokemon Center in the right. Just for those who don't know, Pokemon Center is a place where Pokemon can save energy, meet other Pokemons, and also take a rest. And Pikachu wants to get in the Pokemon Center within 5 seconds. Pretty hard, isn't it? I will unblur the maze and give you 5 seconds to find the faster solution to our problem. Okay? The counting starts now. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Some people, but not me, would find this solution, but most will struggle like me to find this solution within 5 seconds because it's pretty hard. But what about bypassing the maze? Isn't it faster? Maybe there's a better way. Why not a direct line right to the Pokemon Center? Because our initial problem was just to move Pikachu from the left side to the Pokemon Center within 5 seconds. This is just the problem. And how we navigate through the maze is something we are used to do whenever we see a maze. But it doesn't mean that we should repeat the solution each time we see a maze, okay? And first principle thinking is to sometimes break down complicated problem into basic elements and then reassemble them from the ground up. It's one of the best ways to learn to think for yourself. And so now the icebreaker is finished. I just want you to have an open mind because you may have learned a lot about software development at school, but today we will see a whole different aspect of this job. Now let's start. I don't see your camera, but I want to know how many coders are in this room. Can you please raise your hands if there are any coders in the room? Or type in the chat, for example. Yeah, I see a raised hand. And how many developers are in this room? You can raise your hand. Yeah, former dev also count, I would say. You may wonder what's the difference between a coder and a developer. No, I've told you that there are some topics I would have liked to know before starting my career as a software architect. And for me, the journey of a software architect begins when you start making the difference between a coder and a developer. This is the starting of our journey. So we will see together how to make this distinction clear. So let me present you these topics which I've learned and helped me to clearly see the distinction between a coder and a developer. The first one is the skill of doing, of making. This skill is a common skill both a coder and a developer share. But a developer will practice. Practice is something you do when you are not being paid. Like musicians don't get better by performing, by doing their job. They get performing by practicing. They get better by practicing. And that same rule applies to engineers also. And it's not your employer's job to keep your skills sharp for you. This is your responsibility. So you will need to practice and practice again. We've seen the doer skill, and now we will see the negotiation skill. I will tell you a story. One of my first job interviews I had after finishing school was with a well-known IT company in France. And there are many interviews, you know, during the hiring process. And at the end, you have the one with the big boss of the company, like in video games. After you finished all levels, you have the hard level with the boss of the game. And at that time, when I came to meet the boss of the company, he asked me to take a seat and sit down in front of him. And while looking at my resume, he asked me to convince him why should he hire me in this company. To which I replied naturally that I don't have to convince him since it's his company which called me for this job. And then he immediately changed his posture and started to tell me the story of this company, his personal story, and he was also trying to convince me to come there. And better, he even offered me a better salary than initially expected for the position. What I want you to keep in mind is that you should not hesitate to challenge any need, challenge anyone, or challenge anything, which can, of course, lead to negotiation, but you should not be afraid of negotiation. You remember the maze with Pikachu and the Pokemon Center, isn't it? We have a brain, so we should use it to challenge our own point of view and ask ourselves if there is no better way. We've seen the doer skill, the negotiation skill, and now it's the turn of decision-making skill. You may know the donkey tragedy with the old man and his wife, but let me tell you it again. So it's the story of an old man with his wife traveling with the donkey, and people criticize them for being on the back of this poor animal. So the wife decided to walk alongside, to what people reacted saying that the man is cruel to let his wife walk. So the man left his wife on the donkey's back and he decided to walk alongside. And again, people criticized because the man left his wife alone. So both choose to walk alongside the donkey. But whatever they did, no one stopped to criticize him. Sometimes you will have to make hard decisions, not satisfying everyone, but you will have to make these decisions. And also, you are hired by companies to tell them how to do and not just to execute instructions. Your employer is counting on you to defend your objectives and not just agree with everything he says. True professionals have the courage to say no, because, for example, if you know well that getting a job done by the end of the week is not doable, and you are still saying, yes, I will do, in my opinion, you are not doing your job right. Can I ask you, attendees, how do we say no? Can you type on the chat, how do we say no? Do anyone know how to say no? Yes, perfect. It's very important to say just no without adding any argument after. Because if we argue the no, then we are opening the door for negotiation. Say no, but you should also understand why you want to say no. We've seen the doer skill, the negotiation skill, the decision-making skill, and now we will talk about the continuous improvement. Like practicing, which is a continuous improvement, we should not stop improving ourselves. We should not stop learning. And most important is that we should always question what we learned. Even after this presentation, I will invite you to question what I've presented you and what you learned. And continuous improvement is not opposed to asking for help. So don't be shy. Also ask for feedback, like I'll do it at the end of this presentation. And help others, because by helping others, you will also learn and you will confirm your achievements. Like for this presentation, I've asked a lot of help from many people before presenting it to you today. Do not hesitate to ask someone you trust to mentor you. In my case, I have a monthly discussion with my mentor, Peter Even, during which we discuss a lot of things about my professional and also personal life. It allows me to have feedbacks and insights from a senior professional developer who has more experience than me. The mentor can share his lessons learned during his career, and so you can make comparison with yours. After seeing doer skill, the negotiation skill, the decision-making skill, and the continuous improvement, the last one I want to talk about is software craftsmanship. Software craftsmanship is an approach to software development that emphasizes the coding skill of software developers. Software craftsmanship can also be measured by your passion to solve complex problems by simple solutions. And software craftsmanship is also about passion. The passion which will keep you going when things get tough and push you to improve every day. The main mission of a software craftsman is to develop well-crafted software, which of course will lead to happy users and happy customers. But what we don't see is that it requires a lot of learning. Learning by attending a conference, learning by asking for help, learning by giving help, learning by mentoring, learning with a bunch of continuous improvement habits we have. It requires also a lot of practice. And it requires us to be professionals. By professionalism, I mean your career is your responsibility and not your employer's responsibility. By professionalism, I mean also that a developer is not hired to execute tasks or write code, but to improve the business of that company. Like if it was his or her own company and his or her own problems. Because in my opinion, we owe the employer every hour that he or she pays us. And code is just a way to achieve these objectives. Professionalism is also means working with people, not only with other developers, but also with people who are part of the value we are bringing to the company. And last, professionalism is to work both from a technical point of view and from a product point of view. And finally, software craftsmanship is a culture a culture that is cultivated by practicing, by learning, by being a professional, and transmitted by helping others, by mentoring, by sharing with others. So I invite you to share what we've seen together today with other people who couldn't join us. And I'll finish with the last true story. A few years ago, I was working in the IT development team of my company. It's a big team in the company with about 20 developers. Then we made a reorganization within the company, which was called the Agile Transformation. Basically, we wanted to split this big IT development team into small teams dedicated to a very specific domain. And to start this transformation, we first created one team from the big team. And to demonstrate that this new organization will work, we've put all of our energy in that team especially. I was part of that first team, a great team with good team members. Everything went fine, super smooth. We were delivering fast, very fast, and the business results were good also. So naturally, we decided to divide the rest of the big IT team into small teams. And a few months later, one team had a lot of struggle because the domain in which they were working was technically speaking the worst and most complicated. There were not enough developers also in the team according to the wideness of their domain and the complexity of the product in which they were working. So it put a lot of pressure on them, and it affected relationship between team members within the same team. And one by one, the team members were demotivated on that specific team. It was not my team, it was another team. And as a colleague working in the same company, I cannot just stand by doing nothing and not helping them. And as a human being, I wanted to help them because I don't want only to share them happy moments, but I want also to be there when they face difficulties. As a professional, I wanted to help them because at the end, we are all working in the same company with the same product. Therefore, having an imbalance between several teams working on the same product for me doesn't make sense. So basically, I've asked to all teams to try to find a solution to help the struggling team. But excepting the mainly concerned team, no one wanted to do anything. So I finally proposed to leave my team to join the other team so that I can try to help them, for example. But my team didn't accept that, because if I leave them, the velocity will decrease. The quantity of feature my team was delivering per week will decrease, like if any developer leave any team. After many discussions with the management and seeing that no one was doing anything, I've told them that either I go to the other team to help them, either I leave the company by resigning my job, because I'm working for the company, not for a team or another team. It's like I'm in the office working for the company, and my daughter called me to ask me to come home because she's sick and wants me to be with her. And to what I reply that I can't join her, because if I join her, I will not deliver as much as if I'm working in the company. Actually, if I'm working for a company, it is to be paid so that I can take care of my family. If my job doesn't allow me to take care of my family, so the core problem for why I'm working on a company is not solved. That's why, thanks to first principle thinking, we can break down this complex problem in order to see the core problem and how to solve it. just before leaving you, can you, Fox, please leave your feedback in this link? It's a favor I'm asking to you. The link is pretty easy. Just bit.ly/developer-to-architect. It's very simple, simple form in which you can leave any comment you want. That's all for me today. Thank you for listening. And I also wanted to thanks Alexandre Maslow, Peter Even, and Alain Bezacoro, who helped me a lot to prepare this presentation. I think we can start any question.
Thank you, Ismail. So we have some people on site at Erevan. So maybe our organizers there can ask a question about Ismail's talk as well. And for people who are on the Zoom, feel free to ask some question about this this big topic about the software craftsmanship and the journey into a craftsmanship, like your personal journey you described.
May I ask the first question, but to the audience, what is for you professionalism? Okay, I don't know if you can just type in the chat, or for people who are inside, I don't know how they can reply to the question. I guess everyone has access to the chat, isn't it?
Yes. Okay. Yes. At least people on online.
Okay. Can anyone give his or her vision of professionalism?
That's a powerful question. Go out of comfort zone. The first answer. What else?
And you, Olivier.
Oh, me. It's always pursue a personal growth.
Okay.
To be able to work more efficiently and to improve the communication skills as well.
Yeah, great. Do we have more questions? Maybe everything was clear, or everything was unclear at all.
Eric has a question about mentoring. Is your question, Eric?
What is your question?
How did you do the mentoring? What happened? How was it? What's in it? What's in it for you?
Well, I have heard a lot of mentoring, but I didn't know what is exactly mentoring. So I know my mentor Peter Evan, and he's someone in who I put a lot of trust, and I know his career. I know he was working for many company. I know that he's organizing also a conference, and his career was inspiring me. So I just asked him if it's okay for him to be my mentor, and we discussed on how we can have a session, maybe a regular session or something like that, and then we planned to have one session per month, about 1 or 2 hours, in which we can discuss of anything.
And how did you find your mentor? Did you choose him to?
I chose him. It's like Olivier, for example. If I didn't have a mentor, I can contact you and ask you, "Hi, Olivier, can you be my mentor? Is it okay for you to have a regular discussion together in which we can discuss? Maybe you can learn something and also teach me some things. I don't know."
Okay.
There is no process, you know. It's just a discussion between two people.
Okay, so there is a question also on the Q&A about is it an informal meeting or is it on a regular basis?
Yeah, it's on a regular basis. We plan to have this mentoring meeting once a month.
Okay.
And yeah, it's outside of a professional, even if actually we are working on the same company, but tomorrow we can resign our job and work on another company. But normally I think we will still have this meeting unless one of us decide to stop this.
Okay. I have one question on my side. Do you specify some targets, some objectives for you at the end of each mentoring session?
Not really, but starting each mentoring session, we tell our topics. We kind of build the agenda of each meeting at the start of the meeting. And if we don't have any ideas, we can talk about anything from the week or from the month. But usually we try to build a kind of agenda.
Okay. And last question for me, how do you measure your progression?
My progression in what, in the mentoring?
During those mentoring sessions and in your career.
A lot of feedback. I love to ask feedback to improve myself and also to find if there is something I can improve or and analyzing the feedback evolution. I can see that the problem now I have are more complex than what I had initially. So it means that I'm going more and more in a complex way and facing complex situation. And to be able to face complex situation means that you gain a lot of maturity on main topics. And also, for example, when many people come to you to ask also for help, it's also a sign that you gain a certain maturity to be able to answer them, to help them. Even if you don't have the answer, you will be there to help them and try to find a solution together.
Okay. So it's about feedbacks. We always come to this in Agile.
By reducing the feedback loop, we can quickly improve ourselves.
Thank you, Ismail.
We have another question. I think, will you be a member of the Agile France organization? I think. Yeah, I hope so. Even if I'm no more in France, I hope to be still in Agile France organization and come in Paris for this conference at that time.
Nice, because we mentioned a couple of times since this morning that the COVID-19 was part of the was responsible mainly for the digital transformation of many enterprises. So Yes, it's Frug'Agile as well, was born because of the COVID-19. And before we were on site with lots of people, face-to-face communication.
Yeah.
Now we are adapting. So, no more question. Well, if you want to contact Ismail, there is his Twitter on the screen right now, and the chat is left open, so you can always ask questions, and let's have a break. See you very soon, and thank you again, Ismail, for your presentation.
See you soon. Thank you, guys. Bye.